This is a brine pool. We discovered it on a 2020 expedition in the Red Sea. It's a toxic, super salty lake at the bottom of the ocean. Almost anything that swims into this is gonna die. Brine pools are rare and mysterious, and if you're a marine scientist, finding one is a really big deal. So how do you study it? Hint, it involves this thing, the CTD. It's the hero of ocean science. Scientists call it the workhorse of oceanography. It's a critical instrument for understanding how the ocean works physically, chemically, and biologically. It's a bundle of bottles called Niskin bottles and sensors attached to a frame called the rosette. The bottles capture water samples while data from the sensors gets beamed back to the lab in real time. Okay, that's the CTD. Let's dive into the brine. This cocktail of dissolved salt deposits seeped out from beneath the seafloor. Contains chemical traces that can tell us what geologic processes are going on deep inside the Earth, about how oceans form. It's also full of extremophile organisms, tiny life forms that thrive in this extreme environment by converting the chemicals in the brine into energy. If there is life on other planets, those organisms might survive in a similar way. So studying these guys is one way to guide us in the search for life in the universe. So when we discovered the brine pool, the science team really, really wanted to get some samples. From a perch in the lab, scientists can trigger these Niskin bottles to snap closed in an instant, capturing samples at very precise intervals. That's why the CTD was such a key to understanding the brine. So we lowered it down a mile beneath the ship in a daring, unusual maneuver that required both the remotely operated vehicle and the CTD working together, at risk of getting tangled or being destroyed by the brine, but the benefits of having those samples outweighed the risk. The CTD was the only way we could have accomplished such precise sampling. This was a particularly dramatic, rare moment for the CTD, but the less glamorous daily work is just as exciting when you consider that it's the foundation for almost everything we do on the Ocean Explorer. It helps us deploy our submersibles, map the unexplored seafloor, find cool animals, the list goes on. So, meet Carl, our CTD. Does it look sexy? No, but
it's basically the most powerful tool that we have on board. CTD stands for Conductivity, Temperature, and Depth. The CTD was one of the first things that our science team got up and running, and we decided to name him Carl, the humble but foundational explorer on our asset list.
Let's run through a day in the life, Carl edition, to see how the CTD makes our missions possible. Every morning, one of the first things we do on board is cast the CTD to get a picture of what's happening in the water.
So when we cast the CTD, we're basically saying, okay, what is the depth of the area? How deep do we want to deploy the CTD itself? What are the properties of the water column that we want to measure? What is the temperature? What is the salinity? We deploy the CTD. Those bottles are going to be open on the way down. So we're basically just rinsing them on the way down and getting what's called a profile of the data that's coming in real time that's showing us, again, those properties of the water column. And so then I'm sitting at the data acquisition screen. I'm looking at the software and I'm working with the scientists to identify any interesting spikes. So we get to the bottom, we decide where we're gonna fire the bottles. The CTD comes up and we're stopping incrementally along the way at these identified stops to then collect water. Now I have my physical sample and I have my data from the sensor package, and you can combine that and have some interesting inferences and insights about the overall structure of the water column.
When the CTD comes back, the data gets handed off to teams across the ship. First, let's check in with the sub-team.
In the morning, the sub-team leader asked us to do a CTD cast to look at what's called a salinity profile so that they know when they're getting into the water how that's going to affect their buoyancy as they descend. This is particularly important here in Norway because the density of the water changes. Some of the water is fresher, like at the surface, and some of it is saltier as you get down to depth.
The salinity of the water will affect the buoyancy of a submersible or anything else that goes in it. That's why people go to the Dead Sea and the water is so salty that they essentially just float right on top of the water. We utilize the salinity data from the CTG to determine how we adjust our weights on the submersible. In areas like here, where you may have glacier runoff or a lot of rain coming off the cliffs, our submersibles are very sensitive to buoyancy. We do the calculations every dive for how much somebody weighs, how much all the equipment might weigh that we're taking on the sub. The CTD data is really helpful to set the trim just right for doing our mission.
Wait a second, Colin. What's trim?
The trim is a term we use with the submersibles to talk about our buoyancy. So we trim the sub heavy to descend, and then when we get close to bottom, we'll pump water out of our ballast tank, and it trims it neutral. We're collecting samples, we're doing film work. All aspects of our work are affected on the way that we can handle the sub. The CTD data that we get from the science team really does help us. There's so many things that help us to do what we're out here to do. It's another link in the chain. It's another aspect of the whole package that makes us do our job a little bit better.
Another key link in the chain, another part of that package, is mapping the seafloor, because
one of the biggest unknowns of the ocean is what the seafloor looks like. So we're starting to build or contribute to what that picture is.
That's why when we're on mission, we're mapping 24/7, working in the shallows during the day, mapping the deep by night. And to get accurate maps, once again, we turn to Carl, this time to tell us how quickly sound is moving through the water.
Our tool to map the ocean floor is our multi-beam echo sounder. These instruments are engineered to send sound out of the sonar. That sound travels through the water column to the seafloor and then reflects back, and the sonar will hear it.
We calculate the depth of the seafloor using the time it takes for the sound to hit the bottom and return to the surface. The longer it takes for the sound to return, the deeper the seafloor. But the speed of sound changes depending on the water's temperature, salinity, and pressure. So when we cast the CTD, its sensors can give us a very detailed picture of what's happening in the water.
So if the CTD goes down 650 meters, we're gonna get a value, and that is a pretty dynamic value, and it's definitely a key piece to the quality control and mapping.
We want those accurate calculations because we want accurate maps. And we want accurate maps because being able to see the seafloor in detail unlocks so much crucial information. Some of the seafloor features we map influence ocean currents, and ocean currents are big drivers of weather and climate. So that gives us more accurate climate models. Plus,
the topography of the seafloor is going to feed into where we might see larger mammals, because it all kind of works into the food web. Our smaller species migrating to certain spots on the seafloor because there's a hot spot or there's a seamount, and that has an upwelling that also allows for a lot of biodiversity. So that's having the bigger marine animals come in.
We collect water for all kinds of different things. I'm a biologist, so any of the biology that we're interested in, like the plankton, and then the things that eat the plankton that are larger, and then the things that eat the plankton that are even larger still that we like to stick tags on, we want to know how they're moving around and interacting with these ocean layers. And so we use the CTD to basically derive all of that information. It sounds really complicated, but it's actually one of the most fundamental tools of oceanography is the CTD, the rosette, and the Niskin bottle sampler.
Thanks, Carl.